continuously harassed in those days. The tenacity of the prosecuting authorities and the medical authorities was just vicious. We were hounded and harassed all the time. And as you know, I'm the most arrested, most jailed chiropractor in the world. I was arrested 12 times and sent to prison 4 times. Mm-hmm. All for the terrible crime of practicing chiropractic and helping sick people.
Born at home, never had a shot, drug, pill in their body, never been sick. Chiropractic works. These guys are proof. Amazing. Right, Lucas? Right on? Awesome. Good stuff.
Hi, I'd like to welcome you to the 3rd annual California ICA State Convention in Costa Mesa, California. This convention has brought together 700 to 800 chiropractors and staff and family members to gather in the principle and the philosophy of chiropractic. This evening especially, we have a wonderful tribute to a pioneer who stood for the philosophy and still stands for the philosophy, who lives the philosophy, who went to jail for the philosophy, and at 91 years of age, still practices with the philosophy embedded in his heart. And that's Dr. Herbert Ross Reaver. As you know, Dr. Reaver was the most jailed chiropractor, served as vice president for B.J. Palmer, for the ICA, and truly, him and his wife, Millie, are two dedicated individuals serving mankind with chiropractic. As you will see from this evening's festivities, a man of purpose, a man of dedication, a man of sacrifice, a man of love, and a man of service through chiropractic. Dr. Reaver, we as a profession owe you a tremendous amount, an amount that we can never repay you. And Millie, what you stood up for and what you gave to our profession can never be matched. But I know this, that with people like the Reavers being the foundation for what our profession is based on, we have only one way to go, and that's up. Doc, Millie, we thank you for all that you gave. We love you. My children love you. And most of all, our profession and the world loves you.
And I think that when they got about halfway through the parade, when a guard grabbed me by the back of the neck and jerked me back from that window and put me back in my cell. And I learned the next day that somebody from City Hall had called the superintendent and said that it was going to be a communist riot.
That we heard as youngsters. I'm a 1968 graduate of the Logan College, and the stories we heard about Herb Reaver throughout those years gave us a depth of understanding, put roots in our profession, and gave us a broad knowledge of the prices that have been paid so that we may practice chiropractic the way we practice it today, so that literally tens of millions of Americans today receive care because of the efforts of Herbert Reaver. Now, Jailbird Reaver, as he was known throughout all those years, went to jail so many times, and so many times it was his patients that got him released. Herb will go down in the history of chiropractic as one of those people who made a difference on a global basis. He's been a strong supporter of ICA principles and ICA chiropractors and ICA's attitude towards service to people. I think it's a wonderful thing that we have him here with us in Costa Mesa in California. He's a humble man, but he does not have a humble principle. He's dedicated, he's focused, and at 91, he's still in love with chiropractic as you and I know it today. And Herb, thank you for allowing me to have comment on you and to share your profession and your principles and your love for chiropractic. Thank you once again to Herb Reaver.
As I went out my door, they grabbed me, threw me back in, beat me, and I think they intended to kill me. But I bled a lot, but before I bled to death, I came to and was able to call for help. Yeah, I adjusted people. I adjusted my fellow prisoners quite often. I adjusted my guards. As a matter of fact, I adjusted the captain of the guards.
You did.
He turned out to be a good friend.
You did.
An autographed original, Joe Willie Namath football. Goes to Dr. Earl Shaw.
David Wu, come on up. David Wu.
David, are you here?
The next one is a $300 value. This is from Absolute X-Ray Solutions. Chris Ferraro.
Here we go.
See anybody? I got $350, now $400. I got $350, now $400, now $400. $350, now $400.
I want you to know that there's probably at least $1,000 in here for our Pioneer Fund. So give yourselves a hand. That's really beautiful.
Explained how you were taking the pressures off of the nerve roots, and that how Mother Nature was going to step in and do the curing.
Dr. Reaver and Millie are chiropractic warriors. You know, very rarely do you find somebody who's practiced for 69 years, 91 years old, his wife, his sweetheart, who stepped into his office when she was 14 years old with tuberculosis. Her parents were ready to send her off to all these, you know, fancy clinics to medically treat it. And one of her friends, who was a patient of Dr. Reaver's, told her about Doc Reaver and said, you need to try this before they send you away. And she went in to see Doc Reaver without her parents' consent. She didn't tell her parents because she didn't think they'd approve. And through chiropractic care, Doc Reaver knew that her body would heal if he corrected the subluxation. And of course it did. They became sweethearts years later. They got married. She became his receptionist. The two of them still run a chiropractic practice 69 years. Gang, I can tell you that the ICA is very proud to have Dr. Herbert Ross Reaver and his wife, Millie Reaver. He was vice president of the ICA under B.J. Palmer for 2 terms. Very close personal friends. When we bring Dr. Reaver up, he's a humble man. He won't get up here and show, he's just a very humble man. He just knows that chiropractic works. He's witnessed it. He was telling me they weren't coming in for backs, crick aches, and strains. It's not what they came into my office for. They were coming in with tuberculosis. They were coming in with cancers. They were coming in with all that kind of stuff back in the 20s and 30s. And you know what he said? He never once diagnosed a cancer. Because that's not what he did. He corrected the vertebral subluxation. Knew that nature, knew that innate would heal that body if there was no interference. Full life expression. I tell you what. What's instilled inside of him is something we can all have instilled inside of us. It doesn't change. When you hear this man tonight and you hear his wife tonight, you will hear chiropractic history. Before we bring them up, we have a tribute for them that we'd like to show you. We're going to be showing some slides, playing some music. Are we ready? Do we need the lights dimmed? If we could dim the lights, please. Dr. Herbert Ross Reaver. Dear Herbie, I have started writing you a letter several times. Each time I find myself word bound. I can't find the right words or say them right to express my deep and profound gratitude and appreciation for what you are sacrificing for people you have never seen, never will, unborn, dead and forgotten, whom you love and admire, which is my way of saying, doing what you are for the good of mankind in general. No one person in particular, and everybody purposely. When one man will actually do such a deed, he is one in a million. Men generally are weak. They take path of least resistance, slide the toboggan downhill, roll along with the mass, agree with everybody, slobber over them, and when time has come to an end with them, they have left no imprint behind. They have done nothing. They awake, drowse, sleep, die, and nobody misses them. Not so with you, Herbie. You are cutting a road for liberty of health and freedom. Few such stand out, but America has had a few. Patrick Henry, Thomas Paine, Benjamin Franklin. Our modern days have seen a few, and you are one of them. Courage, it takes lots of it. But Herbie, when a person has a deep set of conviction of truth, it doesn't take much backbone to stick to it. Believe it, live it. That's the trouble with the great mass of the unwashed. They are dirty inside, refuse to scrub out the dirt, live filthy and live contented and satisfied with everything, as is never taking any interest in wanting to improve conditions to help a better man for tomorrow. I love you, Herbie, because you love the things I love. If chiropractic had 1,000 men like you, we would lick the world and add 1 million years a day to many millions of people. And what a world that would be to live in. That there would be no Korea. Them's my sentiments, Herbie, and they come from my deepest convictions. Them's the things I've been wanting to say but couldn't find the words until this day at 3 a.m. when I feel the urge coming on. Somehow Lyceum doesn't seem the same without you, Chappie and or Millie, being here helping us decide issues. I know you can't get away before September, or can you? Will the sheriff bring you out? Handcuffed to him? Wouldn't that be a stunt? Ask the sheriff to bring you. Handcuffed. You couldn't get away? And you would be in his custody all the time, day and night. And if you can't come, how about Chappie and Millie? We need the Reaver family represented. Sincerely, Dr. B.J. Palmer.
Wow.
Lights, please. John, put that all up, everything up if you could, please. There we go. If you can get the lights all the way up. Everything up. All right, gang. Well, now's the time. So we'd like to bring up the true pioneer in chiropractic today, the man who wouldn't give in, the person who went to jail, said, I don't care what you do to me, I want to see what you do to me. Because I ain't backing down. Spent his time in jail. BJ said, Herbie, come on out. Come on, we need you over here. No way, I'm not going to give in. Stood his ground. Didn't practice in medicine without a license. He practiced chiropractic. I want to bring up Dr. Herbert Ross Reaver and his wife, Millie. Come on up, guys. Get her up there.
I'm all right.
Yeah, you got to have this one too.
Oh, all right.
Doc, you got to hold this. Millie! Here, Mill. Look at that, BJ. Oh, you're beautiful. Married. This is their honeymoon. Never took a honeymoon. This is it. Whatever comes up. Whew. Millie said she said everything. There's nothing left to say. She's shaking. There's a chair if you need to sit down. Are you okay? There we go. There we go. Hold your leg.
There's a chair.
Right over here. Maybe Millie can tell a little bit about what she said yesterday at Life West. Millie, will you share what you said yesterday at Life West for us?
I don't remember.
What was the first question the question everyone had on their mind?
Well, the... No, the first question they asked me was how I met Doc. And you told them I was a patient, so you don't have to repeat.
What was the other one about do we still?
They asked if we still had sex.
Those students.
And I said yes, but not as often.
But it's just as good.
But hey. But it gets better.
You hear that?
The older, the better. The older, the better. And when I went home, he said, what was everybody laughing about? He didn't know I said that.
She said, the older, the better. Oh, this is such a wonderful couple. They're so humble. and they're so proud to be in chiropractic. It's absolutely incredible. And Doc, I'd like to, if you'd like to say a few words. And
right in here?
Right. No, you don't have to do that. You're wired up. You're going to blow up if anything happens. 91 years. I don't think it's going to touch you.
Can you hear me? Thanks, Ron. It's certainly a pleasure for us to be here. I know there's been a lot of hype about my appearance here tonight, and I'm afraid you're going to be disappointed because I don't have any great pearls of wisdom to lay on you. You guys represent where we are and where we're going. I represent where we came from and how we arrived here. There's an old saying, when a professional body neglects to remember its history, history tends to repeat. Terry Ronberg recently said, one of the irrefutable facts of life is that those who fail to remember history are condemned to relive it. We shouldn't forget our history. I guess when I'm gone, it'll be up to historians to surmise what it was like to practice this profession of ours in the old days. We were despised. We were publicly humiliated. Investigated. Hounded. Entrapped. Used entrapment on us. Innumerable trials. And arrests and convictions, and for some of us, prison. I'm a slow talker, and I'm trying to think of some more stuff to tell you guys.
Doc, what was it like in jail?
What was it like in jail? All right. For those of you who have never experienced it, it's hard to explain. It's a whole cross-section of our society that no one is aware of it unless you've experienced it. It's prison is no joke, that's for sure. Lay another one on me. How many days in jail? I was put in prison 4 times, and my first time was 9 days. Second time, I think 20, 21 days. It's been a long time. Third time, maybe 30 to 40 days, and then they gave me 6 solid months.
How many have questions for Dr. Reaver? We have 2 microphones set up on each side of the room. Please get in line. Come on, you can just get right in line, and we'll go from one side to the other, and you can ask Dr. Reaver any questions you'd like about practicing back in the 20s and 30s. And Dr. Reaver, sit down.
We hear a lot of talk. I know apparently BJ used to talk a lot about clearing out the prisons and clearing out all the sanitariums. And just maybe you can add light, or maybe you know some of the work at Clearview or Forest Park.
Well, I know a little bit about Clearview and Forest Park. They were in existence when I was a student out at Palmer. But other than that, I don't know of any procedure to clear out sanitariums. Not much of an answer, I know, but I don't know.
Doctor, I have a million questions, but I'll ask two. The first one is, since back when you started chiropractic, how did you choose a field that was totally unknown?
How did I do what?
How did you choose chiropractic when it was unknown so far back and unrecognized and despised?
Oh, it wasn't all that unknown. I graduated in 1928. That means I went to college in 1926. I used to be a professional musician. I played in dance bands, and I played on a boat in the Mississippi River. We docked at Davenport, and I had a health problem. During the intermission, during the dance intermission, there were some students there from the college got to talking to me, and I became interested in chiropractic. So when the season was over, I went back and enrolled in the college, entered the clinic, and got on the staff of WOC, which was the radio station. And that's it. By the time I was out of college, I was cured and ready to tell the world about innate.
Can I butt in? Can I butt in?
Sure.
He was walking on crutches at the time when he was playing as a musician, and he'd set his crutches down and play in the band. And the students saw that and had him to come up to the clinic. So while he was playing in Davenport, he went to the clinic every day. And he seen what chiropractic, or felt what it was all going to be about. He went home, took all kind of odd jobs, so he got enough money to come back. And when he came back to Palmer, he worked bussing dishes during the day, and he played in the band with Vic Spiderbeck's band at night. And Dr. Palmer says Herbie was the cleanest looking kid in class. He had one pair of corduroy pants and a shirt, and he wore it every day. But on Saturday and Sundays and Friday nights when he played in the band, he was all dressed up in his tux. He never tells the whole story of things.
The other question I have is, your many years of practice, we went to school and we learned orthopedic, neurologicals, all these things. How do you assess a case now, and what's your initial evaluation? If a patient lays on a table, do you consider the autonomic nervous system and think about these things and organ diseases? How do you evaluate a patient when they lay down on the table? I know you have a lot of experience and a lot of innate thinking. How do you go about it?
How do I evaluate a
patient? How do you evaluate the treatment of the patient with all your years of experience?
You pal?
I guess what you mean, what do I do with my sick people?
Right.
Well, the doctor means well, and I know what he's, I know where he's coming from. It's no great secret. I get my patient's history, and I determine their subluxations, and start adjusting them. that's it. If I talk right and if I do my job good, they stay with me and get well. But of course, I failed on some. I failed to convince them of the true value of correcting nerve root pressures and depending on the recuperative powers of the body to get them well.
Dr. Reaver.
Yes, doctor.
What or who was your main influence or motive for you to continue practicing chiropractic without a license, so they said back in those times?
What inspired me to keep practicing?
Yes.
After all the arrests and jails?
What or who inspired you to keep practicing?
What or who? Just hungry to teach that next patient the value of chiropractic and the value of innate intelligence to cure us. That's it. Yes.
Dr. Reaver?
Yes,
I don't have a question. I just want to say thank you for letting us have the privilege of practicing chiropractic in today's world. And there's nothing more I can say other than thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
I had breakfast with Dr. Jim Sigafoos this morning. And we were talking about the old time days, and I was saying that it was, I was explaining the viciousness of the prosecuting authorities and the medical authorities in those old days, and the enemies of chiropractic and what they would do to try to kill our profession. And his words were, they're still there, except that they're more subtle. And that stuck in my ears, because it is true. They're still there. They'd like to put us down. Yes, doctor.
Hi. When you actually became a DC, how did your friends and immediate family react to the fact that you had become a doctor of chiropractic and gotten into this profession? Were they supportive of you, or did they denounce you? And how did they feel about you fighting for the cause and actually going to jail for what you believed in?
Oh, sure. Everybody that knew me was for me. And everybody that knew about me was for me. And we had a hell of a following with petitions to the governor and everything. But we couldn't crack any nuts, man. When they sentenced you, you stayed there, brother.
Yeah.
You stayed there until you served your time.
Dr. Reaver?
Sure, everybody was supporting. Yes, doctor.
Dr. Reaver, I'm a chiropractic student, as well as there are quite a few chiropractic students here. And on behalf of myself, and I think as well as them, I would just like to thank you from the deepest part of my heart. You are such an inspiration to us, and you can be such an impact on us for the rest of our lives. When times are tough, and we look back towards the people like yourselves and the pioneers, as well as B.J. Palmer, we can only thank you. And there's not enough thanks, because if it wasn't for the people like you that fought for chiropractic, dedicated your life to chiropractic, we would not be chiropractic students right now. I just have one quick question for you. A lot of us can only read the green books and only talk to the people who knew B.J. Palmer. What was it like working side by side with him?
What was it like working with B.J.? Well, I was his vice president in the ICA, and of course he was my teacher in school. And he's just inspiring. That's as a student, he inspired me. Well, boy, I was telling. I also had breakfast with Fred this morning, and I was telling him that when I came out of college, I was gung-ho to teach innate intelligence to the world. And in the ICA, it was great working with him. There was no nonsense about him. Yes, doctor.
I've heard stories about jailed chiropractors and how they continued to practice while in jail. The correctional officers and even the prisoners, the people would come to the jail and be treated by the doctor while in jail. Did you have that opportunity? Did you treat any of the other prisoners while you were in jail?
Oh, yeah. I adjusted my fellow prisoners. I adjusted the guards, some of them. I even adjusted the captain of the guards. But the first time I went to prison, I found myself slipping in cells, adjusting prisoners, and slipping in the guards' little cubby holes and adjusting. And I thought that was pretty damn sloppy. So every other time that I was sentenced, I would insist on them, anyone who wanted an adjustment, I would insist on them getting an order from the captain of the guards or from the superintendent and going up into the dispensary and adjusting them. And I felt that was a much, much better professional way to do it. Also, it was a hell of a good way to let them all know what was going on. Yes, doctor. Yes.
Dr. Reaver, I had the opportunity to meet these two yesterday, and what a fantastic pair, I tell you what. Millie, you know I'm going to make you talk right now. She's scared to death to talk, and I told you, she did a fantastic job yesterday at LifeWest. I think all the students that are here will agree with me on that. Millie, you told a tremendous story yesterday. Chiropractors today worry about their bill getting cut by the HMOs or whatever insurance they can't get on. You told some stories yesterday about the time when you moved to Florida with the baseball players and some of the things, that the tragedies that happened with that. And if you could relate some of those stories and some of the players, I think everyone would be interested in that.
Well, Chappie and I guess some of you may know Chappie, I don't know. He was our son. And, oh, I'm getting off of it. I'm talking about baseball players now, right? My other son, we'd go to baseball games every night, minor leagues. And the one ball player was from Dominican Republic, and he was talking to me, and he said he couldn't play baseball anymore, that the doctors examined him and said this was it. So the game was called, and Doc came back, and I asked Walter how he was going to get home. And he said he was going to walk, and storm and terror, and I said, no, we'll take you. He said, oh, no, you get in trouble. You get in trouble, because prejudice was terrible there. They couldn't walk on the same stride of the street that you did. Well, anyway, Doc says, come in and see me. I think I can fix you up. And lo and behold, he came in the next morning, and Doc adjusted him. He went back, played ball, and played ever since. But we became acquainted with many, many ball players. And whenever he would tell everybody to come in town to go see Doc, and I would meet them at the airport, and I would be arrested many a time having dark-skinned boys in my car. And it went on, the big leagues come in. Our first friend was Chico Ruiz. He played with San Diego Padres. I don't know if any of you remember him. He was killed, he had an accident in San Diego. We were godparents to his children. And then from there it grew. Tony Perez, and well, the latest now is Danny Tarbell, and I think maybe many of you here know Danny. We gave a baptismal party on Danny. His parents asked if we knew of a church that would baptize him. I went to six Catholic churches, and when I'd say, Father, it was the babies of color, they'd say no. So I did find one church that the priest said that he would baptize him. So we gave a great big baptismal party, and we had over 50 ball players and their families there. And cars just kept circling around. 2 weeks later, we get a phone call calling us nigger lovers and threatening to tar and feather our child, sending Doc on calls, and he would get on calls, and there'd be nobody there. We had bomb threats to our cars, and Doc always took care of the ball players and never charged them. And finally, one day, I was on the phone with Mrs. Rios, Chico's wife, and we were going to have another baptismal party for their child, which we were godparents to. And they told her to hang up, and she hung up, and they said, Mrs. Reaver, and I said, yes. And they said, you're wanted in the hospital immediately. Your husband was beaten and left for dead. So I went to the hospital, and he was sitting on the table, blood all over him, his raincoat, and he was covered with blood. And they says, we don't know what we're going to do with him. He will not accept a tetanus shot. And I says, well, let me take him home. And he couldn't at that time remember just what had happened. So he woke up about 5 o'clock in the morning, and he said, I think I know who did it. There were two nice, handsome men coming in, and they'd come in as the last patients, and only one would take an adjustment. And they came in for, what, about a week or two? I guess casing the place was about a week or two. Mm-hmm. So he started home, and he came out the back door, and the one of them pushed him in, held his hands behind him while the other beat him over the head with a 2x4. And he was supposed to be dead. They thought they killed him. And the detective lived across the street, and he said he'd try to find out what it was all about. And it so happened that the John Birch Society and the Ku Klux Klan had hired these two men from Canada to beat him and to kill him. And prejudice was terrible. I used to drive the ball players around and was stopped all the time. And just awful. But we have wonderful friends of ball players. I could go on and name one after the other, and we're still very good friends. And all their kids now are ball players. And we're hoping that Danny does come. He's the one that we had the first baptismal party on, but the one he took the beating over. So that's my baseball story. My son Chappie was a writer. His first book was called Moot, and he won a Edgar Allan Poe Award. Then his second book was A Little Bit Dead, and he won the Golden Spur Award. His third book he wrote and mailed on a Sunday, and he died on a Monday. And Ron and I was, Ron and my son were good friends. And Ron and I was talking today about Chappie, and it never hit me before that he died on his adjusting table. He worked hard the day before, laying carpet and so on, and he said, I'm going to the dumpster and put this carpet in before it gets too wet and be heavy, and I'll go back to the office and stretch out, take a little rest for office hours. So his receptionist came in and says, come on, chap, it's time to get up now. Patients are starting to come in. He was dead. He died right on that table. And I never thought anything of that until we talked today, Ron, about him dying on his adjusting table, just laid there to rest, and he just died. beautiful, beautiful boy, and a good straight chiropractor. He takes after his dad.
You talk better than I do.
Dr. Reaver,
yeah.
This is a question. I don't know which one of you is going to answer this, but it's apparent to everybody in this room, or at least it's apparent to me, that you're both very much in love still after many, many years, and that's really nice to see. I saw a lot of my friends, even through my later stages of chiropractic college, even get divorces or have breakups and different things, and some of my friends after that have been in practice have had a lot of trouble with their wives, because a lot of times wives don't see in the same things that the doctors see, or vice versa. The spouse doesn't see the same as the doctor. Is there anything you can tell us of how you can stay in love for so long with all those external forces working against you?
I can say something.
Go ahead.
I think the wives have to take a back seat and realize that chiropractic comes first. That's their husband's first love. And the ladies who are doctors, their husbands have to take the back seat. But chiropractic is, I always say, is his first love, but it's such a beautiful profession and such a wonderful thing. And you don't get hurt over it. Be proud to see him get all those sick people well. And you don't need anything but your hands.
Doc? Hello. I brought my kids here tonight to see you, and they almost made it. All week we've been telling them that we're going to go see the world's most jailed chiropractor, and they've been telling their friends at Montessori school all week, and the teachers are looking at them funny. But they're excited, because when I was young I was sick, and now I'm well. Chiropractic. My kids, I want to thank you from the bottom of our heart, because they don't have to experience that. They've never been had a shot, drug, or pill and been well and asleep. So I want to thank you for doing what you've done so they can get chiropractic. And we love and appreciate you. Hey.
Those are beautiful words, Doctor, and you tell him when he wakes up that my eyes were pinned right on his
spine.
one quick question that I had. You know, what excited me, because I literally had a miracle case. What was the most profound case that you experienced in your years of practice? Miracle healing.
He means
the stone girl.
Oh you mean a real outstanding case. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, tell us about that stone girl.
Yeah, the stone girl. She was a very famous case in the old days in Cincinnati, Ohio, the girl who had turned to stone. The history was that she was out bicycle riding. She was about 20 years old, I think, that when she had the accident. And somebody in front of her stopped real sudden, and she went over the handlebars and landed on her head. And she, from that day on, she gradually became stiff. And she was tabbed the stone girl because her muscles did stiffen up like stone. And she had gone the medical route completely. And finally, they asked me to take on her case. And the first time I saw her, she could move her eyeballs and her tongue. That was all. Otherwise, she was totally paralyzed, and the skin was hard. So I started adjusting her, and she started to get a little better. As she got to the point where we could sit her in a wheelchair and let her sit up to the table and be fed, as opposed to being fed right in her bed. When she got to about that point in her case, it's when they threw me in jail again. And I was in there for 6 months. And by the time I was released, she had reversed back to her old condition, and I didn't see her again. But while I was in there, her parents and friends organized a huge campaign to try to let me see that stone girl a few times a week in the presence of someone, some guard in prison. But we couldn't crack it. The Cincinnati City Council wouldn't hold still for it. But that was probably the most outstanding case that I ever saw.
Thank you.
I can tell you an outstanding case. About 5 years ago, I had a very bad fall, and I landed up in Mayfield Clinic and then Cleveland Clinic, diagnosed as spondylolisthesis. And they said I was too old for surgery, but if I did have surgery and lived through it, they'd put a lot of nuts and bolts in me, and I'd be paralyzed in the wheelchair the rest of my life. And they sent me to a clinic and fed me 21 pills a day for the pain and started me on an exercise program. And I was in a wheelchair. In fact, I was in a wheelchair when I went to my son's funeral. And the sixth day they left us come home for about 3 hours. And I told Doc what they were putting me through. And he says, well, that's enough. Let me adjust you. And he adjusted me, and when I went back, I had to go back the next day. My wheelchair was gone, but I was using a walker. And he snuck in the hospital on Wednesday and gave me another adjustment. And there was a lady there that just wanted to force me medication in me constantly, and I'd keep refusing. And she said, well, I guess you're going home. When you go home the next time, you won't come back, will you? I said, you're wrong. I'm going home now. And I went home. And here I am today. The only thing that's hard on me is walking steps. Otherwise, I go every day, do something every day. But to me, that was a miracle. And he's the cause of it.
Dr. Reaver,
yes.
What I'd like to ask you is I was never able to see the Lyceums, obviously, back in the old days. And I'd like to know if these meetings here or what you've seen this weekend are comparable or equal to what the Lyceums used to be back at Palmer. And I would also like to ask you one other question, which is, what do you think of chiropractic today? Are you happy with what you see now? Are you proud to see what you see this weekend?
I'm sure proud of what I've seen here. You better believe it. I love you guys, and I hope you're all going to be. I hope you're all going to be straight chiropractors.
Yeah.
As for Lyceums in the old days. Yeah, you guys have a lot of enthusiasm, but, oh man, we were full of fire in those days. That's Okay.
Hi. I'm from Panama, and I have been married to a chiropractor for 5 years now, so I know chiropractic for 5 years. Down there, nobody knows what it is. And going to all the conventions, and the first time that I heard the chiropractic story, I was like, wow. And I think that I am lucky now, because I always thought these people did so many things, and now I know a Siga Foos that I admire, and I feel so much every time that I hear him speak. But now that I see you, I can say thank you, because in Latin America, they don't know yet chiropractic, even if there is a few doctors down there. Now I can go and fight for what you and all these people here believe, because it's a beautiful thing, and chiropractic first, and it works, and it's beautiful, and thank you.
Thank you, doctor.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. As I stand here waiting to talk, my heart's like racing, probably about 120 beats per minute.
That's pretty fast, man.
But it's only because of what moves me and what drives me. And I listened to the last guy that spoke before me on this side. And in the spirit of that, I want to ask you a hypothetical question. I want you to imagine that not just the ICA members were here, just not the ICA, but the ICAC that's not here tonight, the ACA. I want you to imagine if all the chiropractors, where we're so much separated within our own profession, if they were all here tonight, and you were up there and BJ was beside you, maybe you could give us some type of idea of what BJ might, how BJ might address us all to form some type of union. Because the thing that drives me and pulls me so much apart is the separation that we have within our own profession. And I was just, if BJ was up there right now, and what you're talking about, you know, coming from the heart, putting the cards on the table, what would he say to us right now? What advice would he give us for us to join together? Because it really hurts me to see our profession divided as much as it is in so many different ways. There's just a small percentage of the chiropractors here tonight. What would he say to us?
Well, it hurt BJ very much. The divergence in our profession, and he felt the same as you're feeling right now. What in the hell can we do to unify ourselves? He tried hard, and he didn't make it. So I don't think he would have anything to say. Other than everything he said all his life, everything that he did all his life, in an attempt to get us to all see the same light. That's the best I can answer.
Thank you.
A last question for the evening.
What size of a Yellow Page ad did you have when you were in practice? I'm just kidding, by the way. Can you share with us one of your more memorable experiences with BJ Palmer? What episode most stands out in your mind?
I told you. Nobody knows about it.
To tell you the truth, Millie was was closer to him than I was. And can you tell us anything about your experience with BJ? She and She and BJ knew each other pretty well. My association with him was always, I think, professional, because I loved the guy and he loved me, but we were always, my association was professional, whereas he and Millie were good pals.
We used to write like I'd write the date today, whatever the date is today, I don't even remember, and the time. And when I'd receive a letter from him, it would be the same date and time. And we corresponded a lot. And I was out there I went out 6 months. And I came back because of Doc's trial and so on. I didn't get to study anymore. And he and I became very good friends. And we had, Chappie was with me, we had dinner together in the evening. And he would, whenever he had a thought, whether he was in the bathroom, the kitchen, the living room, no matter what, he'd write it on a piece of paper. And the next morning, he'd collect it all, and he'd sit down, and then he'd start writing from there, collecting all of his notes. And he was a lonely man. And everybody looked up to him and admired him, but nobody had the nerve to put their arm around and say, I love you, or be affectionate or kind toward him. And I tried to be a daughter to him, and he accepted me as his daughter, and I just loved him to death. He couldn't do anything wrong in my book.
You know, I'd just like to share a last story about Dr. Reaver and Dr. Reaver's son Chappie told me this story when I graduated chiropractic college. He gave me my first green book, original green book, Evolution or Revolution, and he sent me off to see his parents back in 1981 on my way home from Michigan. No, my way home to Michigan from Marietta, Georgia, and I spent about 6 or 7 hours with Doc and Millie, and we went for dinner and just had a really enjoyable evening.
Did I give you an adjustment?
You gave me an adjustment. Best adjustment I ever had after being adjusted in school for 3.5 years. Doc asked me, he said, how do you adjust? You adjust with your hand on a shirt or you adjust in your hand on a skin? I said, I adjust over a shirt. And he says, mixer. I was shaking for about a year after that every time I adjusted somebody. Anyways, we were talking about it, and Chappie told me, their son Chappie told me a story. We were sitting in Chappie's office one evening, and Chappie told him about when his dad, Doc here, was in jail, and they used to let him out of jail at 2:01, 1 minute into the morning. And I guess old Doc used to like ice cream. So the first thing he wanted to do when he got out of jail, and Chap was maybe about 6 or 8 years old, maybe something like that, and Doc wanted to go get some ice cream. So that was after a 6-month stint in the jail, and they went and got some ice cream and they went back home. And they had this house, like he said, he had a home office for so many years, and they had a big sign on the front yard and it said chiropractor, and there was a little light underneath that said in, for the chiropractor's in. And he had a switch inside the front door when you walked in, like you'd turn off around your front light, you'd put the switch on or switch off, and he walks in, the first thing that Doc Reaver did was go for that switch, because it's been off for 6 months. And Millie said, oh, Doc, let's just have one night of sleep. And Dr. Reaver said, Millie, the chiropractor is always in. And he turned the light on and it all lit up the front yard. And both Dr. Reaver and Millie are warriors in chiropractic. And what we'd like to do right now, and I want to just share with you a few things, what we'd like to do, and they know nothing about this, is I'd like to bring up Dr. Bobby Braille. And Dr. Bobby Braille, of course, as you know today, is the president of our ICA. And Dr. Braille has an award for Millie and Dr. Reaver.
And I feel humbled and privileged, considering the fact that you've been in chiropractic longer than I've been alive, and I have the privilege of standing up here as the president of ICA and addressing someone and giving some thanks to someone who, with BJ, held the helm of this ICA that we all love. And I know that there's nothing that I can say or do or that we could do that can repay you for what you've done for us in chiropractic, in our lives, in ICA. But as a small token or gesture, what we'd like to do, which I believe is long overdue, is to present to you the lifetime ICA membership emeritus status. So they'll be recorded from now on in the history of ICA that Dr. Herbert Ross Reaver, a pioneer in chiropractic, will get permanent lifetime ICA membership emeritus status. We thank you. We love you. We love both of you for all that you've done in chiropractic. Thank you.
You've spent in jail for chiropractic, knowing and paving the way for us to be able to make this world a better place to live. BJ Palmer, Doc was telling me, BJ Palmer is not turning over in his grave tonight. BJ's sitting up somewhere saying, Herbie, a job well done. So thank you guys very, very much. We love you very much.
Is a pioneer that has made the ultimate sacrifice that many of chiropractors today would not be willing to do. He actually was able to put it on the line, get arrested, go to jail for that which we know and practice with a license given today. He is a pioneer that I don't know if there'd be many of you here that would be willing to make the kind of a sacrifice that he made. Chiropractic has flourished because him and people like him did not give in, did not give up, and were willing to put it all on the line. I and every chiropractor who ever puts our hands on a patient owes a debt of gratitude to Dr. Reaver for the time he spent in prison, for the time he spent standing up for chiropractic, for the time that he would not give in and would not give up his principles. It's because of him and men like him and chiropractors all over the world who have done what he's done that I am allowed to be here today as president of the ICA, as a practicing chiropractor. And so for the thousands of chiropractors who've come after him, who've had the privilege of practicing chiropractic with a license, and for the millions of patients that we've had the opportunity to take care of, all we can say to you, Dr. Reaver, is God bless you and thank you for all that you've done for us, for chiropractic, and for mankind. Thank you very much.
The thing that struck me is that his dedication was to principle, whether it be the principle of chiropractic, the principle of doing right by people, the principle of fairness and equality. He stood for those things and stands for those things today. And I'm just personally so thrilled to have had the experience of talking to this man who has had almost twice my lifetime's experience in chiropractic and has seen countless thousands of patients, has seen lives turned around to be changed, all because of his steadfast, rock-solid commitment to the principle of the chiropractic profession and to the future that could be held and could be earned by this population, this country, and this world by an understanding and an application of that principle. This profession owes Herb Reaver and the men of his era and the women of his era more than we could ever possibly conceive. There isn't a single chiropractor today in the world that is not in some way, in some shape, or in some form standing on the shoulders of Herb Reaver and Millie Reaver and the countless thousands of chiropractors like them. They're the last of a breed. They're the ones that knew the bite of the sheriff's grasp. They're the ones that heard the clang of the door behind them. They're the ones that suffered incarceration in circumstances and situations we can't even dream of. And they did it because they loved a principle, they loved a concept, they loved an ideal, and they would not sacrifice it in the face of any challenge, any threat whatsoever. Our undying gratitude belongs to them, and I am so eternally thankful for the privilege and the opportunity to have known and to know Herb and Millie Reaver. God bless them, and God bless all like them over the years. Thank you.
I hope that I'll be remembered as having contributed something to society. I hope that I will be remembered as having left this world better off as a result of having been here.